This is Papa Smurf. You're listening to Our Lifestyle, the podcast with ODB and the Mayor.
Yo, it's Our Lifestyle, the podcast, episode 143. You heard that right. We rolled in with some dire straits. Can't go wrong with Money for Nothing. A little bit more on that track a little bit later in the episode. First off, if you're new here and you came to listen to the podcast because of Brian McCormick, thank you very much. This is a mini Truckin' inspired podcast, where we talk about trucks, hip-hop, old-school BMX, 80s, 90s, all sorts of different topics. So we would ask that you subscribe to the podcast, and every Friday when we post new episodes, you'll, of course, be notified. So by now, you've seen the cover art, and you've seen us make the few posts early on Friday that this episode features Brian McCormick. And for anyone that's been around the truck scene a long time, you surely know Brian's name. He was tied to multiple publications, including Mini Truckin', Truckin', and then, of course, Street Trucks. It was really an honor to sit down with Brian. He gave us a lot of time, so it's a real good, what I'll call an in-depth interview. And it was a lot of fun to kind of pick his brain on things that were going on back in the Street Trucks days. Now, most of you guys that have been listening each week and consistently, you know that we're celebrating the 20th anniversary of the premiere issue of Street Trucks Magazine, which launched, believe it or not, August 1999. Now, we've also committed to going through, for now, at least the first 15 issues and kind of talking a little bit about those. And I'll go through issue number 6 and 7 on this podcast a little bit later towards the end. Now, Biggity Mike the Mayor, he is not gallivanting around. He's my co-host. He's actually getting ready for his daughter to head off to college this coming weekend. This weekend, I should say. And we wish them all the best. They're going to be traveling from South Florida up to Central Florida. And to Ashley, Mike, Shannon, hope you guys have a safe trip. They're going to be listening, no doubt, early on Friday, as they always do. Certainly appreciate the fact that Mike and Shannon took kind of the week off, if you will. Mike had a lot going on this week. And then, of course, they're going to focus on family, which we always say family first, and getting Ashley over there to where she's going to be going to school. So with that being said, wanted to remind everyone that this weekend is SICKNIC 2019. That's a car and truck show there in Gonzales, Louisiana, which is kind of a stone's throw from New Orleans. It's SICKNIC. If you want more details, search SICKNIC on Facebook or Instagram. Now, typically with most shows, if you're on Facebook, there's an event page. And if you select that you're interested or hopefully you're going, that's going to be how you can join the discussion and learn more about what's going down. And then when Greg and the team there at Custom Car Show Productions, where they need to get information out, they'll, of course, post it there. Now, on the last episode, you heard from Tosta. And Tosta is one of the MCs, or the MC, that will be there at the show. So you kind of heard some of those details about SICKNIC 2019. The show, just to be clear, is August 24th and 25th. It's at the Lamar Dixon Expo Center in Gonzales, Louisiana, as I mentioned. One of the big draws this year is going to be the Feltham Fabrication Awards. So if you are into anything custom or you like paint, custom paint work, look up Feltham, that's F-E-L-T-H-A-M, Fab, on Instagram. You'll be blown away at the quality that he's putting in to these. Mike reminded me recently, they're not skateboards, so to speak. They are metal, but those things look really, really good. And the top honors at the show will kind of be in the running for those really awesome awards. So great job to Jason Feltham at Feltham Fab. Really looking forward to seeing those this weekend at Sicknick. Of course, I will be there, and it's going to be another awesome weekend. Okay, so this episode, for any of the new listeners, we kind of go through various sections, always very regimented on what we cover. So this segment's going to be about 30 minutes, and then we'll roll into Brian's audio. Mr. McCormick, again, he's someone I would call an OG. I learned some things as well from the interview. And man, just the one thing I'll say, two words about Brian over the years is work ethic. I always enjoyed reading Truckin editorials, as well as the features that he wrote, the write-ups, if you will. And then, of course, at Street Trucks, man, back in those days, and Brian kind of hits on it, you know, the magazine was how you got information. There wasn't really a social media network out there. Of course, the internet had kind of started popping up in the late 90s, but you were talking like email, real primitive websites and things like that. Now, the forums did begin to kind of grow, so he kind of mentions that. There's a couple forums that have been around a long time, and there's a few that are still around, but you know, before MySpace, there was kind of AOL Instant Messenger. Many of you guys will remember that, and then there were some of the chat groups. I know early in our scene, it was like Street Source. That was one of the main ones the mini truck scene all kind of, you know, gravitated towards. But it was really cool to sit down with him, so we'll get to that audio a little bit later. Okay, on the last episode, this is the recap, we actually had Randy. We called that episode NC Randy. And Randy Frederick is a Negative Camber member. He's one of the five original members, and he talks a little bit about how that chapter started. Now, we can't guarantee every Monday we're going to have an episode, right? But we did kind of tell the Airhead Nation and the listeners in the past that we will, you know, drop a Monday episode here and there for Mini Truckin' Monday. We enjoy doing those, and it was a lot of fun to put that one together. Now, what I liked about episode, let's go back to episode 141 for a minute, because I didn't cover this last week, or on Monday, I should say. Now, on 141, which was a week ago, seems further, you know, a lot longer ago than just a week, but we had Cope Kessler, and what I really liked was the backstory on Cope's van and really the passion that he had to take it to a whole nother level from version one. Version one of the van, and you guys saw the photos we posted on Facebook and Instagram, was a really nice clean van. It was kind of orangish paint, white. It had billets, super clean looking. Of course, he kind of told the story how he wanted to take it to the next level, and damn did he. The blue Blaupont van, I'll call it, what it morphed into is something that people are still talking about. I mean, we got so much love on those photos that we posted. On the episode in general, people just loved it. And we're really hitting on all cylinders. Talking to Ruben, you know, we've got a lot more in store. Ruben is a friend of ours, as we call him, Ruben Arteaga. And as you guys know, if you're a longtime listener, he's been really helping us nail down some of these interviews. We've got names on the list. Sometimes we're like, man, we don't know if we're going to be able to get this guy, right? Or this lady. And he's been able to really help us on some of these, and it's been awesome. So far, 2019, we've put out just over, we've got more episodes this year than weeks. And that's really our goal, is to continue bringing great content. And we did that, I feel, with Cope's episode. And that's based upon feedback from the listeners. Now, in episode 142, as I mentioned, we had Randy Frederick. To me, it was great syncing up with a longtime Floridian here that, as far as I know, he's lived here a long time, if not born and raised. And to talk to someone that was one of the originators of Negative Camber, Florida, he's so passionate about cars, trucks, all these different things. And Randy knows, he has been active all these years from 96, even before then with the smaller clubs he mentioned. But from 96, when Negative Camber Florida chapter was created, all those years later, he's still active. And I appreciate that, Randy. So I'm looking forward to seeing a lot more from Randy and really slapping hands with him at Slamfest. We're going to sync up on Friday, and it'll be good to kind of talk about the old times. And I appreciate him and his good friend, Tim, for providing a lot of the photos to us. So thanks again for allowing us to share you guys' story there with Negative Camber, Florida. Okay, next we got general updates. This is brought to you by Hammered Weekend Wear. Visit H-A-M-M-E-R-D weekendwear.com or click the link in their Instagram bio. Ron Perkins at Hammered Weekend Wear, they feature what they refer to as real builds. So iconic mini trucks, different full-size trucks, you name it. Those are featured on their t-shirts and other apparel, including banners and so on and so forth. If you want an awesome shirt, get out there. The two latest ones, he's got the Skatin S10 shirt, which is super sick artwork by Graphic Disorder, as well as the Titan shirt, which features Courtney Hollowell, rest in peace, and Jimmy Graham of Jimmy Rodden Customs. So you got the old school Titan, the new school Titan for an epic shirt. Again, hammeredweekendwear.com. So the general updates, as you guys know, Mike and I usually will just kind of provide something in general, maybe not specific to the truck scene. My only update is Devious Customs, man. Big ups to Jeff Davey. My suspension kit was delivered earlier this week, and super stoked. Jeff even went the extra mile, and I had asked him, hey, could you get that powder coated for me? He said, no problem. And then that way, once it got delivered, it was less for me to have to do locally in terms of the powder coating. But if you need air suspension, whether you're talking AccuAir, specific suspension kits, just go to deviouscustoms.com. Jeff is, you know, someone, again, I would call a friend of ours. He has been in business for around 20 years. He even has an Amazon Prime show. The shows have continued to get better, and I would highly suggest that you go out there and check them out. I know they're just going to continue to stay, as we always say, on the rise. Really enjoyed episode 6. I just recently watched it. But again, I don't know how quickly I'll be able to get the kit installed because really I'm still looking to put the motor back in, the transmission. That's not going to be hard, but I'm just trying to kind of go one step at a time. On these Lincolns, it truly is one part at a time. You can't really get too far ahead of yourself. So more updates to come. But follow Jeff at Devious Customs on Instagram or check out his website. Okay, next, the podcast updates brought to you by our friends at the West Coast Influence. If you go to minitruckfilm.com, you will land on their website. They have t-shirts, some remaining sizes left. They have custom Hot Wheels. They also have the Blu-ray and DVD of the West Coast Influence. Now, I did just recently talk to Radar, and that written interview is going to be in the next issue of All Time Low magazine. We are super stoked for that. And speaking of All Time Low magazine, they just announced the new cover and it is epic. It features Damian Davis's truck. So be on the lookout. If you want to go out there to atlmagazine.com, order one issue or subscribe. Those are bi-monthly now. So there's 6 issues per year. But just know the West Coast Influence, they support our lifestyle, the podcast, and we definitely want to give them a huge thanks for what they've done. And again, I mentioned recently, Radar drops a little bit of a hint on maybe what's to come for maybe a remix, if you will, of the West Coast Influence DVD. So with all that being said, here are the podcast updates. We are going to add additional ballistic shirts to our site, ourlifestylepodcast.com. The reason being is due to popular demand, we had to order more shirts and we did so in black. So what we did is we went through the sizes that we sell the most and those shirts will be added very soon. I would highly suggest that you go out to ourlifestylepodcast.com. Check it out. There are various shirts out there. There's different categories as well. We got hats, miscellaneous, shirts, so on and so forth. Go out there, check it out, and let us know what you think. order some merchandise if you haven't already. We certainly appreciate it. Now, additionally, we do have another shirt coming early next month. Now, we think everyone's really going to like this one. It's totally different from what OLP has done in the past. However, it encompasses what we love at this podcast. So everything 80s, 90s, pop culture, etc., all I can say is just wait. We try to put out about maybe four shirts a year, and sometimes it does seem like we're putting out more than that. But if you look at it from the time that we have to do the pre-sale, and we collect those orders, and then we pay Graphic Disorder, and then for those shirts to be printed, that's a process that could easily take, you know, 6 to 8 weeks, maybe a little bit longer, a little bit less, right? So with that being said, just be on the lookout early September. Mike and I will drop the new artwork. We're not only going to have a shirt, but we're also going to have some other merchandise, and we certainly appreciate all the support from the listeners with each shirt that we release. Big thanks to Graphic Disorder for always coming through on epic artwork, epic screen printing. If you need anything for shirts, especially if they're show shirts, or you're looking to ramp up your brand, go to graphicdisorder.com. He has the pricing listed there, and it's more than fair. You have to hit them up for specific artwork, and then they will let you know what the cost is per each item or for that artwork. Once you pay that, you'll be on the list. You'll have Eric or one of the other talented staff there, including Andrew and others, that will do the artwork for you. Once you approve it, then you'll be in line for the printing. So graphicdisorder.com. Okay, next, I've got the Airhead Nation updates. And as you guys know, this is kind of a newer segment that we've added. And if Mike or I, if we see any story or a post about someone in the scene, so to speak, we'll cover that generally here in this section. Now, the last, I'd say, month or two, we've talked about a guy named Kevin Smith. And Kevin Smith, not the guy from Jay and Silent Bob, but Kevin Smith is a mini trucker. He has a really awesome, he has a couple trucks, but he has one specific that you know, Jimmy's Rod and Customs built. And I met him through that truck, basically, going to shows. You know, rest in peace to my dad. When, you know, we would go to shows, you know, Kevin was there. And my dad and Kevin and I, we would always talk. My dad and Kevin would talk even longer. He's a really good guy. And he's been going through a lot of health challenges. And he had a post on August 16th. He says, well, after 5 months of being away from home, I got to sleep in my own bed last night. Finally got my daily driver registered. Long story, lost the original title and had to get a new one from the previous state sent to me and several other setbacks. He kind of goes on to talk about a bunch of different things. And he does say at the end, the downside is because I've been away so long, there is a crap ton of things I need to get done. Good news is I am still around to know about it. So I don't know if Kevin's been able to hear some of these, because again, he's literally been in the hospital for that long. But we certainly appreciate, we've been rooting for him. He's a really good guy. And if you get a chance, you ever get a chance to meet him, go out there and slap hands with the homie. If you find him on Facebook, you'll see that he still has the Jen Lacey, rest in peace to Jennifer Lacey, avatar on his Facebook photo. So that's the one update that I wanted to share from a Airhead Nation perspective. We'll, of course, hit you guys with more in the coming episodes. Okay, the scene updates brought to you by Sparkles Detail and Custom Car Show Productions, including Orange Beach Invasion, Scraping the Coast, Sicknick, which is this weekend, and then Bayou Showdown, which is 2 weekends before Thanksgiving. So, Sparkles Detail, if you're at a show and they're there, they will clean your ride. You just approach the booth, let them know what vehicle yours is, and they'll come over and they'll clean it. If you drove it there and you got all the road grime and whatnot, they will take care of it and get all of that taken care of so that you'll be set up for success at the show with a clean ride. So this was pretty cool. Now, I'm kind of saying this is a scene update because it came from Chip Foosh, you know? I mean, he's like the guy in terms of hot rodding at this point. But someone tagged me in this earlier this week, and it was a guy named Peter Domus. So thank you so much. He mentioned me in the comment, and I had to check it out. This was a post on August 15th from the official Chip Foose, and it says he's feeling nostalgic. Chip says, these photos were taken in 1979 when I was 16, my Redline Pro Line, which was later stolen in the 80s. I'm currently building a new one to look just like this old one, time to collect parts. And then you got the first photo of Chip doing literally a tabletop. And then the next one where he's doing the, you know, the cross, you know, where you spin the bars around halfway. Now, we posted a photo, I want to say maybe in 2018. And it was one of our most viewed photos on Facebook and Instagram. And it was a story that I caught wind of and I shared it. There was a guy that was visiting Chip Foose's shop. And it was like on a weekend. I think it was a Saturday or Sunday. And I believe they do tours there. And the guy was from the UK somewhere. And, you know, they're kind of going through there. And I don't know, they have like a handler that kind of takes you through and talks about what they're doing. And he sees up in the rafters a bike hanging. So he asks the person, hey, would he want to sell that? And you're thinking, you know, I'm thinking, there's no way. Well, apparently they went over and asked him, and Chip was like, yeah, I'll sell it, no problem. Now, it wasn't this bike that we're talking about here, but it was another BMX bike that he had. And he not only did he sell it, he also took a photo with the guy that bought it, and he even signed it, which I thought was really, really awesome. So we talked about that many moons ago, but that's the little Chip Foose tie-in there from when we shared the photo prior. But go out on Facebook to the official Chip Foose, and you will see that photo. Okay, next we have Robbie Bryant on August 18th. He posted, and as you guys know, Robbie works very closely with Greg when it comes to Orange Beach Invasion, which is that show that's put on in March, and Mike and I talk a lot about that throughout the year. If you're looking to come down in the spring break area, or if you're looking to come down in the spring break time frame and really enjoy that southern weather, you want to come down to Orange Beach Invasion next year. So we'll have more on that. Just make sure you're subscribed to the podcast, and we'll bring you additional intel on that show. But Robbie Bryant also had another show called Slammily Reunion. And he goes on to say here, quote, I want to throw a huge thanks out to all my staff that has supported Slammily Reunion all these 11 years. Another huge thanks to all those that came and supported the show all the years. Nothing lasts forever. We had a great run. When we started, we never dreamed of making it past the five-year mark. And then he kind of just goes on to say that basically they're going to focus on Lifted Truck Nationals and, as I mentioned, Orange Beach Invasion. Of course, they probably have something else up their sleeve as well, but wanted to bring that to the Airhead Nation. There were a lot of great comments on there. There were folks saying, hey, I went, you know, almost every year. I went all 11. I went 9 of 11. So to me, it's tough when a show leaves. Like one of those shows for me years ago was Showfest. Always loved going to it. They brought it back a couple times and whatnot. But it's just one of those things that happens. So Robbie and Kina, they were very upfront and forthcoming with the information about this being the last year. And that was, of course, a Facebook post. I know Mini Nats on Instagram and Facebook, it's Mini Truckin' Nats. They also posted a teaser asking who's ready to see the special edition Mini Truckin' Nats shirt that will be dropping this week. So we've got our eyes peeled for that. And cannot wait to go to Mini Truckin' Nats next year in Maggie Valley, North Carolina. It's going to be a blast, so stay tuned for that one as well. Okay, next, what's hot on social media? This one's brought to you by Garage Gear Clothing. Visit garagegearclothing.com if you're into awesome artwork and badass trucks on shirts, whether it be a mini truck, a dually. Man, they even have a shirt with a side-by-side on it. Get out there, check out the merchandise at garagegearclothing.com. So this one was maybe about a week ago, but I did want to mention it because of the sports tie-in. This is the only sports item we'll cover on this episode, by the way. But Jay-Z signs a deal with the NFL. Now, arguably, some people say Jay-Z's the biggest hip-hop icon of all time. He's the greatest. You know, everybody kind of throws around that whole GOAT term. Now, there's no denying his success. He's invested a lot of his money, And I recently saw an article where, man, he's worth I don't know how many millions and hundreds of millions of dollars. But this decision, it seems like it was met with some opposition. I won't go into the whole thing, but obviously the NFL is trying from a PR standpoint to kind of move ahead of all of these, all the craziness that they've had going on, right? You know, to the point that, you know, they've had the players doing some of the things that they're doing and whatnot. And you had a lot of people that were kind of boycotting the NFL. So what do? They kind of go out and say, well, look, we'll hire Jay-Z and he's going to be in charge of the Super Bowl halftime show. And I think just entertainment performances in general. So there were some people that were kind of basically saying, you know, it was pretty messed up what he did. And I was like, well, so let me kind of understand this. There's an article on thegrapevine.theroot.com. And this is just doing a basic Google search. This is where I kind of landed. But apparently someone or a couple people are claiming that Jay-Z even told Jermaine Dupri, who's the other kind of hip-hop icon producer there in Atlanta area, to turn down a similar deal, I think it was last year. And I thought that was kind of ironic because it's kind of like, well, you know, no matter what side you're on with this whole thing that they had going on, you had a lot of the hip-hop acts that were saying, look, we won't do the Super Bowl halftime show because of the stuff that they've got going on with, dare I say, Colin Kaepernick, right? Whether that's right or wrong, whatever, not going to get into that. But it was ironic, after all that, dust settles, then Jay-Z goes and signs the deal. So not saying he's not a smart guy, because I can guarantee you they're paying him a ton of money to do it. But I just thought it was ironic. So it'll be interesting to see how it plays out. Okay, the show schedule, this is brought to you by All Time Low Magazine. Visit atlmagazine.com. Get out there, subscribe. Don't just take our word for it. If you've never seen an issue, simply buy one. They are shipped out pretty quick. And check it out. If you like it, go back to atlmagazine.com and subscribe. They also have shirts and other merchandise available. So here's what we got. This weekend, Sicknick, they're in Gonzales, Louisiana. Really looking forward to this show. We're going to be there, as I mentioned. And then Acro, I believe, is hosting the pre-party. Now, last episode, or the last couple episodes, you heard Daryl Poe. It was actually on episode 141, and he talked about Down for Dennis. That's another show, and that's going to be in Princeton, West Virginia, and that's a charity show. That's on September 14th. Then you've got Bayou Showdown. Okay, Bayou Showdown, as we've mentioned several times, even though it seems like it's on the heels of Thanksgiving, it's actually 2 weeks before Thanksgiving, November 15th through the 17th. This is a car, truck, hot rod, lowrider, and bike show. It's at the Harbor Center in Slidell, Louisiana. So follow Bayou Showdown Show on Instagram and search Bayou Showdown on Facebook for more information. And then let me back up, because I jumped to November pretty quick. You want to also go out on Instagram and follow Mini Madness Inc. Okay, Mini Madness is ramping up for Slamfest. In Slamfest, it's simple. You want to come down to the south in October. The weather is beautiful. It's October 12th and 13th in Tampa, Florida. If you go out to Mini Madness Inc. on Instagram, you can find more information. There's going to be plenty of vendors there, and we're really looking forward to setting up and bringing a lot of exclusive content to all of the listeners. So, big ups to Mini Madness. This is going to be my 23rd in a row Slamfest. Started in 96, and I'm not stopping anytime soon. We're really looking forward to going out there and supporting the scene. Make sure you get out there, follow Mini Madness Inc., or search Slamfest 2019 on Facebook. Okay, and then as we jump from Slamfest, I mentioned Bayou Showdown, and then you fast forward to February of 2020, it's going to be a huge month for mini trucks and the truck scene in general. First, you got Mini Truck Showdown. That is in Bakersfield, California, at the Kern County Fairgrounds, February 13th through the 17th of 2020. You can go to minitruckshowdown.com or click the link in their Instagram bio. You want to get out there, support the scene, and just know that they're on board with OLP, and we certainly appreciate that. Then the following weekend, if you're there, you can either fly or drive over to Conroe, Texas. Now, you'd have to be living under a stump, as they say, for you to not know about Lone Star Throwdown. LST, as it's been obviously dubbed, Lone Star Throwdown is February 21st to the 23rd, 2020. You can go to lonestarthrowdown.com. I highly suggest that you pre-register for the show. I know you're thinking, ODB, dude, we got plenty of time. They only pre-register about 2,000 vehicles. At that point, it's cut off. Now, you will see in the next all-time low magazine, Radar hints at what they're kind of doing to open up some registration at day of show. But that's not guaranteed, because I can tell you the lines get very long. If you think that you're going to be able to make it, or you think you're going to go, just pre-register for $60. And then, worst case scenario, your vehicle's not ready. You can still go to the show. You got your armbands. Or you can always transfer that up until, I think, February 1st of 2020. So let's say you can't make it for whatever reason. You can transfer it to the homie or club mate. It's about 183 days from this recording. And again, all of that information is on lonestarthrowdown.com. And then maybe the biggest, maybe the baddest mini truck show of all time, the Southeast Mini Truck and Nats, also known as Mini Truck and Nats or simply Mini Nats. Go on Instagram and type in Mini Truck and Nats. You can click the link in the bio that will take you to minitruckandnats.com. You can pre-register now for only $30. Their website is super easy to use. And let me tell you, $30 to pre-register is great because it's $10 per spectator for a weekend pass. So if you're going to go with your significant other, you're going to spend $20 anyways. May as well bring your ride out and show it off. It's in Maggie Valley, North Carolina. Really looking forward to this show. And if you look on Instagram, you'll see it's April 24th through the 26th. There are people flying out from everywhere. I know the homie, Craig, he's even coming out from Oregon. I know there's going to be a lot more. Let's see how many states we can get out there to represent the mini truck scene at Mini Truck and Nats 2020. Now, lastly, a couple weeks ago, we mentioned the new tool to track all of these shows. And by now, if you're listening on Friday, you would have seen on Thursday. So yesterday, we launched a new calendar, which we refer to as the OLP official show calendar. Now, we love our printed calendars. Don't get me wrong. We've seen them from HammerDWeekendWear, All Time Low Magazine, so on and so forth. But what if, and we did, bring out the official OLP show calendar? If you want your show on that calendar, hit us up. We've got different advertising packages. We'd be happy to work back with you to talk about your show and add it to our official digital calendar. Once you subscribe to that calendar, you're going to be in the know. You won't have to go to Facebook or Google to start searching for these shows. Many of you guys are picking vacation time in November, December, so on and so forth. Dude, you go right into your phone, type on calendar. As long as you have the OLP official calendar selected, all of the shows that are on our approved list will display. Biggity boom. We even have links in there to the website or the Instagram profile. You can't go wrong. Get with us. Hit up Biggity Mike the Mayor on Facebook. That's Mike Murray on Facebook, my co-host, and he will get you the information about the advertising packages. So in just a minute, I'll go over the two Street Trucks magazines, and then we'll roll into the audio with Brian McCormick. So I'll just wrap up these other updates kind of quickly. Industry updates. There was an article about the 2020 Chevy Corvette Stingray. Will, imagine this, reportedly cost more in 2021. That's a no-brainer. Stuff continues to go up in price. So that was the one industry update. Sports, we covered it earlier, just with that one Jay-Z tie-in. Movie and music. So I did want to mention that the new Snoop Dogg album did drop on Friday 8/16. Go out there and check it out. I don't think it's a bad album. There's nothing's going to capture kind of the early albums, whether it be, you know, Doggy Style, The Dogfather, The Last Meal, you know, some of those iconic Snoop albums. But I did really like the kind of main song that you're hearing a lot of, and it's called One Blood, One Cuz, featuring DJ Battlecat. The message on that song is basically unity, and especially after Nipsey Hussle's untimely death earlier this year being murdered, basically Snoop's giving a lot of love to Nipsey Hussle and what he was trying to do with bringing unity to, you know, basically the hood. So it's a really cool song, and I think it's the truth, man. You know, these gang members shouldn't be killing each other and things like that. I mean, it's so petty, the stuff that goes down. So go out there. The album is called I Want to Thank Me, and you'll kind of hear at the very end, there's the outro, I Want to Thank Me by Snoop. But it's a pretty solid album overall. I mean, sure, there's some tracks I don't like. It's kind of growing on me a little bit. But definitely check out One Blood, One Cuz. Beastie Boys, there's an article on OK Player. That's OKAYPlayer.com. Beastie Boys announce vinyl reissues of three classic albums. And it goes on to talk about Paul's Boutique, Ill Communication, and To the Five Boroughs, each hitting a different five-year milestone in 2019. For its 30th anniversary, Paul's Boutique will be pressed both in standard black 180G wax and the limited edition violet colored vinyl. If you guys don't know, people collect vinyl like there's no tomorrow. A couple years back, we had the homie from Rappin' and Snackin'. If you go out to Instagram and type in R-A-P-P-I-N and A-N-D Snackin', just like it sounds, you're going to see his amazing collection. And there are people out there, especially BC Boys fans, dude, they collect this stuff like there's no tomorrow. So I would venture to say that those are going to sell out pretty damn quick. No celebrity updates this weekend. Tech update. I talked about the Samsung Fold earlier in the year. It had obviously got pushed back. I think it was several weeks ago, Samsung said, hey, they're ready. They fixed the issue. And there was an article on news.samsung.com that talks about the Galaxy Fold is ready for launch starting in September. We will see. I don't want a foldable phone. I'm just throwing that out there. GameSpot.com. So this is our retro gaming update. Nintendo Switch Online's free NES games for August now available. I'm a subscriber to the Nintendo Online service. I really like it. You can obviously, if you're into retro games, I mean, there's tons of free ways to get these games and sideload them on your NES or whatever you want to do. I kind of talked about that on a previous episode. But I love the ease of going and updating the Switch or just powering it on. And then biggity boom, everything online within that ecosystem is right there. The Kung Fu Heroes and Vice Project Doom, this is a Nintendo tweet, are coming to Nintendo Entertainment System, Nintendo Switch Online, and that was on August 21st. Now, this was kind of cool. On this article on GameSpot.com, they said the Vice Project Doom is particularly notable because it hasn't been officially re-released since it originally launched on the NES back in 1991, making this the first time it is appearing on any system in almost three decades. And then you can watch the trailer from the Nintendo tweet, which is at Nintendo of America on Twitter. Okay, high-level overview of Street Trucks, and I know I'm kind of going over my time that I had set in my mind, but Issue 6, which was March of 2000, had an F-100 on the cover. Really cool table of contents photo. You had an awesome rendering in here that I think was done by Jason Rushforth. Was a cool dude. I hung out with him back in the day at SEMA for like a whole week. Really talented guy. In here, you had heavy haulers. So Chevrolet GMC had just debuted the new dualies back in that time period. And it was the 2001 HD trucks. It's always interesting to kind of go back and look and say, hey, did I like the truck then? I know the new trucks are getting a lot of hate. I don't particularly like them. But looking back at these old guys, I definitely dug the 2001 trucks. In the Groove with Brian McCormick. Again, he is our title guest. You'll hear from him shortly. So always enjoyed reading that editorial. Really nice Pathfinder. This was a 93. It's green. It was featured by Courtney, and it was titled Path Grinder. Had some badass billets on it. Really super low. All tweed interior. Thing was awesome. You had Reality Check. This was a Midwest show. A lot of good coverage from the trucks that were there. Some iconic minis as well. Mean Green Machine. So you had an 88 to 98 Chevy extended cab that was laid out. This was a 97 Chevy extended cab. And it even had the paddle gauges in it. Again, thinking back just over 20 or just under 20 years ago, this issue was March of 2000. The guys were still rocking paddle gauges, man. Nothing wrong with that. People still are today. You had Alter Images add suspension to a Mini. Another F100 that was featured. Really nice truck. Showfest 99. Now, I was not at this one, but in this coverage, you'll see Bill from Extensive, his orange van, which, of course, that came up in the Cope Kessler interview. And it was cool to hear who actually had it with the Gendro tie-in and a couple of the old school guys, including Cope and Pat Nickel. That was freaking awesome. Who would have ever thought? Slamboree coverage. Two pages. Again, awesome show. You had a Bronco 2 that was all pro street with tweed. Really badass Suburban. I remember seeing this Suburban back in the day on negativecamber.com in the early days of their original website. And this thing is still sick today. I think if it were to come out, it would still whip up at shows. It had House of Color orange, ultra orange, and it faded into Tangelo orange. Really kick-ass 97 S10 extended cab that was laid out, lay in frame. Courtney Hallowell's Last Word, and that was titled Who You Callin' Slacka. And then April of 2000, another classic cover, rocking Colorado Custom Wheels. Love these wheels. And Radar posted this, and I kind of forgot about this badass feature that was in this issue. He also has a cover shot, and the title of this is Special Mini Trucks Section. And his Isuzu Space Cab was on the cover. Now, the full-size Chevy on the cover is super sick. Love the flames. I think it's another truck that could come out and would really hit the nostalgia factor with everyone, especially with the 88 to 98s on the rise, as we always say. It was actually titled In Fuego. And again, it had the flames there, some billet wheels, real clean look, and I think it was just static dropped. You had In the Groove with Brian McCormick, and then you had the feature right after that was Hellraiser. Now, I think this Chevy, it's a 92 regular cab, step-side bed. I think this was on the cover of Sport Truck. And it also has really badass paint, so it has a sick paint job. It has 18-inch Colorado Custom Wheels, the Infernos. And then when they did the feature, which was shot by Courtney Hallowell, the wheels were set up so that the flames were going straight back, just like to match the paint on the doors for the typical, you know, flame job. I think this truck, from the interior to the motor, engine bay, into the bed with the full stereo, and they had a full shot of the chassis in here that was painted. It's another truck that could easily come out and just kill it at shows today. Okay, R2K or Resolutions 2000, the adventure continues. Really good coverage here in the couple pages of that show coverage. Okay, here's a section called Metal Tattoos, and it was by Brian McCormick, and it was talking about all the different wild paint jobs. A lot of the paint jobs that you'll see in there were trucks that had been featured up until that point in this magazine. Painted by a pro, you had Chris Schmitz, GMC Sonoma in here, and this was by Courtney Hallowell. Of course, the photos were by Chris Schmidt and Air Graphics, so it was pretty cool to see, again, a contributor to the magazine with a tech article and really an iconic truck that was on the cover of Mini Truckin'. Okay, the 8th annual Slamfest show, Turning Heads in Tampa. Joe Greaves always does a great job with show coverage. you actually even have Shannon Bullis's Ford Ranger in here. And you guys are going to be hearing more from Shannon Bullis in the near future. Guy really knows his stuff when it comes to mini trucking. Got a chance to slap hands with him again at the Spark Show. Okay, White Lightning, a 64. And this thing, believe it or not, is a Ford Ranchero. So it showed the diversity of the magazine. Really nice, cool feature on that car. Durango, this was titled Deranged. This was a lifted Durango, and it was a 98 version. Really cool stereo. Then you had mini trucks. So when you get to this page, which was like page 95, it says a pair of the world's finest mini trucks, Taizito's supercharged Mazda, and the Isuzu space cab built by Radar Hendrix. Dude, epicness. Not only is the feature on Radar's truck awesome, Taizito's is even that much awesome. They even did a long exposure where they kind of ran, it looks like a light behind it, and it just gave a really, really, really awesome feature. Taiz was like a nighttime shoot. Both of these were by Courtney, and he killed it, man. It really, 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 two iconic trucks. Although the one photo that kind of leads you to believe that it was shot together, they were in that one photo, but each respectively earned their own feature, and it's really awesome that Radar is still continuing to dabble in mini trucks. He loves the scene that much, and he is the guy behind minitruckfilm.com, which is the West Coast influence. Okay, Nobe Nationals 99. We were there. It was a damn good time. There was only there was about two pages of show coverage there, and you had a couple of iconic, or a couple of nice mini trucks, I should say. And that rounds it out. The parting shots at the end was a real cool. I always loved this photo. It was of a girl. She had a long sleeve Street Trucks shirt on, and it says Street Trucks gains worldwide recognition. While checking out the British scene, our boss's daughter donned one of the new Street Trucks magazine sweaters and proceeded to get more attention from the local tea sippers than that historic pile of rocks in the background. And she's standing in front of Stonehenge. So it was an awesome, awesome photo. But with that being said, guys, appreciate you guys hanging in there with us, going and continuing to listen each week. We continue to see additional subscribers. We're continuing to land awesome guests. We're going to have Reno on very soon from AccuWear, which I think is going to be a real fun interview. And we've also had some other names recently that we mentioned that we'll be covering. So with that being said, let's go ahead and roll in to Brian's interview. Now, I will tell you this, we hit the floor running. So it's a little different on how we started this, because when I called Brian, we just immediately jumped in the conversation, and he was like, man, I hope you're recording this, because boom, 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 boom. And he just started laying it out. So it's pretty cool. It starts a little bit unconventional for us, but I like it. It's a little bit different. You guys enjoy it, and make sure you subscribe within the Airhead Nation group on Facebook. Look for that link for the OLP official show calendar. We appreciate all the support out there. Enjoy the rest of the podcast. Oh, and the last thing, the song we rolled into will also roll out of this episode with Money for Nothing by Dire Straits. One of the most successful Dire Straits singles, Money for Nothing, is inspired by Mark Knopfler listening to a man complain about the musicians that emerged in the 1980s. The song features an introduction with Sting singing I Want My MTV. Because of this, this was, are you ready for it? The first song ever played on MTV Europe, not MTV US, when it began airing. So, fun fact there, awesome album, Dire Straits. Love the song. Papa Smurf loved it. You guys enjoy this interview. We got you. DMT. For you. Fresh. Fresh.
Rogan podcast.
Yep, yep.
I mean, you know, there's a lot of stuff pre-Street Trucks that, you know, a lot of people who may listen to your show are my kids' age that don't know these things.
I know. Yeah. And me having a lot of friends like on the West Coast and kind of, you know, I've had the inside a little bit on some of that, but like it blows my mind how it got to where it got to. And I was talking to Brian Good from Grindr recently, and he was telling me that he kind of remembers how he swears. He goes, dude, I think it was like a council run or something. He goes, I think Courtney stood up and told us, like, hey, there's going to be this new magazine. I forget if Stillwell was there, but he just thought it was so cool that, you know, they kind of shared that with the group, you know, because everybody knew how important the magazines were. So I think it would be cool just to hit upon, you know, even if just briefly.
I, you know, it's funny you say that because my memory's for shit. And it's funny you say that because I remember him doing that. And I want to say it was one of the last spring splashes. Mm-hmm. I want to say that's what it was. And, you know, unfortunately Courtney's not here to verify that, but I think that's what it was. I vaguely remember that now.
Yeah. Brian, I went to the Oregon show a few weeks ago and he was like, yeah, he goes, I swear. I remember and he just thought it was so cool because that it was like, You know, the mini truckers out there, of course, like there's that tight-knit community. So he just always thought it was awesome that, you know, even though you guys were spearheading this new thing, that you guys weren't like, you know, the mag wasn't too big to like say, you know what, we're going to share it because these guys are going to be all the guys buying it, you know?
Well, and again, I hope you're, you know, recording this and you can just kind of lead right in with this whole thing is that, you know, this is, you know, that was part of the reason of why we did street trucks.
Yes. And I kind of heard some of that.
To get back to grassroots, you know, that was, and again, that was, I mean, that was the core of why we did it. I mean, there was other things in which we can go into that, but was to get back to that grassroots core, pure enthusiast kind of magazine. Yep. You know, coming from Truckin, you know, it became corporate because we were corporate owned, you know, several times over. And, you know, that to us, that pure enthusiasm kind of a core was kind of lost. You know, it was being replaced with, you know, everything we have to do is based on ads and so on and so forth. And, you know, there's a reason why that has to be. I mean, you got to, you know, magazines make money, and that's why a lot of magazines aren't here today. They couldn't fulfill that obligation.
100%.
Thankfully, we were at a time where, you know, we could, and it's a time when magazines were still the iconic means of communicating that enthusiasm to people. And, you know, that's been, you know, such largely replaced with social media. But, you know, this was all pre-social media. And it was a perfect time to venture out and do our own thing. I mean, there was other forces involved that ushered in this. But, you know, the transition was started with Steve Stillwell, who was like basically a father to Courtney and I. And mm-hmm. Mike and, you know, pretty much everybody there at Truckin at the time who came and went. I mean, he left and he went to Mrs. Yee, who had started Y Visionary Publishing. Mrs. Yee was the widow of Ken Yee, who was part of McMullen and Yee back in the Truckin days.
Right. Anyway, I recently heard that. Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, it goes back to, it was Tom McMullen who had McMullen Publishing, and then he partnered with Ken Yee, was an extremely intelligent businessman, and was really part of that when Truckin really started to grow. I mean, he was the brains behind McMullen and Yee, and then it sold to a corporate, and then, you know, we started bringing in Argus and so on and so forth. Like I said, it started to grow, and when Ken had passed on, obviously, you know, he left a legacy that Mrs. Yee tried to fulfill with starting the Y Visionary. Mm-hmm. And her dream was to have a truck book again. And it just worked out that with Steve leaving, they got together, said, hey, this would be a great idea. And Steve got with Courtney and I and said, hey, you know, if we're going to do this, we need you guys on board. And Courtney and I were both just like, yeah, no problem, dude.
Yeah, you're like, boom. Yeah, because you guys were like a team.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, we were a team. I mean, I started, I came on board straight out of the military. And in fact, I had thought about this. I wanted to talk about this. Was my first encounter with Steve was, God, it had been like 88, somewhere in there.
Okay.
I was hungover at a truck show, showing my blazer. I mean, literally hungover. And, had little ropes around my blazer and all that stuff. And one of my buddies, like, nudges me because we're sitting in the shade, because we're hungover. He's like, dude, man, somebody's effing with your ropes. And I jumped off like, I'm going to kick somebody's ass, messing with my show ropes, around my truck and everything. There's Steve standing there, and he's like, well, if you want your picture of something like, if you want your picture of your truck in the magazine, better let me take those ropes down. And of course, then I'm like, oh, hell yeah, so I'm taking the ropes down.
Sure.
And it wasn't long after that, they actually wanted to photograph my blazer for a feature in the magazine. And I had gotten an accident with it, and so I had to get it fixed, and I told them I'd let them know, and got it fixed, and I let them know. It's like, hey, I'm getting out of the service. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'd like to get this thing, go ahead and get this thing featured, because I probably got to sell it. I have no idea what I'm going to do with my life. Mm-hmm. And they're like, oh, really? You have any interest in being a photojournalist? And I'm like, well, what's that?
Okay.
I have no clue, right? So they, they're like, oh, we're looking for somebody to fill the spot. We just launched Mini Truckin' Magazine, first issue, and you're a mini trucker. And, would you like to try out? And I'm like, yeah, sure. What I got to do?
Right.
Like, well, go take pictures of your blazer. Okay, sure. So I got this. In fact, I still have the camera. It's the old Pentax K1000. I'll probably die with it. It's my first camera. So I shot, of course, now I'm really going through the magazine looking at it from a photographic standpoint, like, okay, how am I supposed to do this?
Right.
So I went and shot photos, and I actually probably still have those transparencies, but anyways, it was good enough. And I wrote Alan Paradise was there. It was Steve and Alan Paradise, Larry Saavedra. I think those were the three. Anyways, they had me write about a show. And so I did a write up about a show, and it was good enough. And Steve's like, when can you start? And I'm like, well, I still got 1 month left in the Navy. And they're like, we need somebody now. And thankfully, my chief at the time was, he knew I was getting out, so he was cool with it. So he let me start. So I actually started there when I was still in the service. I had about 3 weeks left.
Wow.
And then, started from there. And I think Courtney came on board. It was 1990, because I started in 89. I think Courtney came on in 90 or 91. I think it was somewhere right in there. It wasn't long after I had started. So what I'm getting at is, at that time, Courtney and I were, we were young. We were early 20s. Mm-hmm. And so, Steve was, and still is, like a father figure to us. I mean, he really shaped a lot of who we would become over time as men. Mm-hmm. Not just as in a work environment, but just in a personal environment. So yeah, we were a really close team starting then with Truckin' and Mini Truckin'. And then we obviously did lots of other books along the ways, but that was, I think, a core of why when we left to do street trucks, it was us three. Cause we were the closest, the tightest group that we worked well together. I mean, even though we fought like brothers.
Right. I can imagine.
Oh yeah. We it's like I was a managing editor. So I was always on Courtney about, get your stuff done, man. Come on. Cause it's like even where I work now, it's like, I'm a deadline freak because of 18 years as magazine editor, because you had to make the deadline. It's just the way it was. So yeah, we were always arguing and fighting about that stuff, but still we were really tight as a family,
Yeah, definitely. And man, what a roll in. And I just want to, let the listeners know, we got Brian McCormick on, and Brian, we normally start off with how's it going, but dude, I want to start off and say, when we saw you on the West Coast Influence, we saw, and you mentioned earlier that you were in the Navy, And I talked to Ruben recently about it, and you know, want to thank you for your service to the country, man. That's an awesome thing.
You know, I feel weird when people say that.
Oh man, I'm starting off on a bad foot.
No. I feel really weird. To me, it was because I come from a generation where, you know, you either went to college or you went to service. Mm-hmm. That's just how it was. To me, it was just part of what I needed to do, you know. And I mean, granted, I was young and I wish I would have stayed in because I would have retired like many, many years ago.
Yeah.
Times have changed. The military is different now, but.
Yeah, definitely. Well, when, you know, for listeners that watch the West Coast Influence, you know, you'll see Brian in various scenes in there and whatnot. But like, did you kind of find yourself in like maybe the mid 80s, like before you went in the service, early 80s? I want to say in the West Coast Influence, you may have mentioned like seeing some Toyotas and stuff. Like, did you kind of get bit by any kind of bug in terms of the trucks and the vans and stuff like in high school?
My parents were vanners.
Okay. And
yeah, they had, you know, my dad, he had this, you know, custom personalization kind of bug. Most of the stuff, in fact, even still this day, he's almost 80 years old. He, you know, both pimped out and he's always taking care of his truck and adding this and that and so on and so forth. But yeah, they had this crazy van and they'd go to the van runs and all that stuff. And, you know, this is my influence really was actually cruising. Cruising was a thing. And I'm sure it wasn't a whole lot of people's towns back then, but it was like a thing. And everybody had their, you know, lower Chevy trucks, which now, you know, all the C10s, but the C10s were new then. Mm-hmm. And, you're right. You know, yeah, Buick LeSabres and Fleetwoods, and which I'd still like to have a early 80s Fleetwood, dude. People would trip.
Yeah, man.
All bagged out, laid out on wires like back then, because all you had was like center lines and wires, you know, true spokes and stuff. But there was a few guys I still remember. I can't remember his name, but he had a brown Nissan 720. Was done up as much as you could do up stuff then, which was basically go to Pep Boys and find what you could find.
Right.
there just wasn't a lot. A friend of mine, David Harvey, he had probably one of the nicest was Chevy Love. A friend of mine that I grew up with, he ended up getting like this Courier and doing some stuff to it. So many trucks, you know, it was just kind of starting to take off, but it was just kind of the fast one. Of course, I was the kid, you know, I couldn't afford any of that stuff. So
yeah,
I didn't get my first mini truck until I was actually in the service. Right after I was in the service, I got an 86 Toyota. Of course, immediately, you know, cranked the torsion bars down and see how low I could go until I was ripping torsion bars out. Really, you know, this is way before adjustable, you know, air suspension and stuff. So yeah, that was my first, was a Toyota, and then that got stolen. And I had my S10 Blazer, which I would love to have one again.
Yeah, you seem to always like those trucks over the years, like the features that I've read, like in Truckin and all the magazines. Like you seem to like definitely like the Blazers.
I've just always, there was a dude I can picture right now. I was one of those weekends, high school. You know, we all hang out in the parking lots. Everybody cruises by, and this is, you know, back when everybody's running 15s and 18s with as many watts as you could. Fosgate and O'Brien, and you know, all the crazy stuff. And there was this dude that had a brand new, would have been 84, 85 S10 Blazer, lowered on I can't remember what wheels, and big ass sound system. And I remember his license plate said Snowball. I mean, that's just way back.
Damn.
But I can still picture it right now, seeing that thing cruising by. And I was just like, dude, that's it. That is the shit. Someday I'm going to have one of those. You know, and it was 3 or 4 years later, I finally did.
It's cool to me, like even yourself, and we've had guests on where we talk about this, like even you kind of, you know, you kind of went to like, you made it right in the truck scene, like because you got into the publishing and you kind of lived the dream, so to speak. A lot of people would say that, but you still had to have that motivation early on. And when you saw that ride, like that's what, you know, that's what's kind of instilled in your brain, man. That's still pretty cool to me.
Well, like, so we, like myself and Courtney and most of the people actually, that and Mike and Lance and got so many different people that came along afterwards. I mean, we were hired because we were enthusiasts, not because we were journalists. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what, I don't know if it was, maybe they learned because I was one of the first ones who was hired purely because I was an enthusiast, not a photographer, not a journalist. And I was taught the aspects that were required to become a good photographer and become a journalist. Mm-hmm. But it was based on the core of the, of being an enthusiast. I mean, at the time that I was hired, I mean, the Truckin was a Bible.
Yes.
Mini Truckin, obviously, was just starting then, as far as Mini Truckin magazine. I mean, that was, it was the Bible to me. And I said, we had truck shows all the time. I was in Ideal Minis. We had the largest club. And I mean, we were going to shows all the time. And it was just, it was the lifestyle because there was so much going on all the time. And I said, that's what actually got me, myself, and the others in as well, was being an enthusiast and doing all those things and going all that stuff. I mean, you know, what better people to have to go out and cover truck runs than people who were already going to the truck runs?
Yes, you definitely. Well, speaking of California and growing up in that era, did you ever find, like, we'll ask guests about skateboards or BMX, right? Like, were you into, like, riding your bike when you were, you know, growing up?
Skateboarder.
Okay, got it. Yeah, it seems like with many truckers, or especially of that era, you basically have, you know, one or the other. And I always, you know, we've kind of made that connection here on the podcast.
Yeah, I mean, in the 80s, there wasn't a lot else. I mean, now, you know, life is way more diversified.
Sure.
You know, there wasn't, I mean, you didn't have as many options. You were a BMX guy, or you were a skateboarder or a surfer. But if you're a surfer, you also skateboard as well. But
yep.
I mean, those were, you know, the two real big things to be doing then. I mean, this is all pre-X Games, pre-snowboarding, pre-everything. In fact, this funny is, I remember when I was in the Navy, we were watching TV sitting in the barracks, and there was something about snowboarding that come on TV. And I remember telling the guys that someday that sport's going to be in the Olympics.
That's crazy. Yeah. And think about it. And now I think even skateboarding's getting ready to get in finally, you know.
Is it really? Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's either BMX or skateboarding. It's one of the two. And I always thought, like, the Olympics, like, to go off on a tangent there, like, I kind of enjoy watching the Olympics. But I think, as to your point earlier, Brian, like, as – there's so many things to do in life. You know, you can watch movies on your phone, play games, whatever. So it almost seems like the Olympics, the ratings are down every, you know, those 4 years. So I almost think it's awesome that the committee is trying to, like, expand it a little bit, you know, make it entertaining. You know, you want the younger crowd, hopefully, to enjoy it. So maybe that's why they're doing those things.
Yeah, probably for sure.
Well, I wanted to bring this up because we're kind of, like, on the subject of, like, when you started at Mini Truckin', like, the magazines, as you know, especially Mini Truckin's, highly collectible now, right? Guys, I just met a couple guys in Oregon. They're like, oh, yeah, I have the complete collection. A couple weekends after that, I met a couple guys. Oh, yeah, I bought the first issue on newsstand. How many people can say that, right? And it's crazy to me that there are so many people out there that have a complete collection. But in your world that you lived in, right, for so many years, like, did you keep the magazines, or were you just like, dude, I'm living this, man. Like, I don't have room for this stuff.
It's funny you say that, because, which I live in Northern California now, and I still have my house in Southern California.
Okay.
That I've been in for 20 years. And I'm actually selling it right now, and I have to go down this weekend to clean out my sheds.
Oh, boy.
Filled to the brim with basically every magazine that I was a part of and every issue. And I have, up to a certain point, probably 2000 or so, on Mini Truckin. Mm-hmm. And I have every, I said, there's every issue. There's every issue of Truckin back to the original ones. There are tons of magazines in my stories,
right,
that I've
like,
got.
What am I going to do with these? Don't throw them away. You know that.
The one thing that's always, people go, why do you keep this stuff? I go, but this is a significant portion of my life here. Mm-hmm. This 18 years of what I did and lived, and it's documented, you know. And I go, there's going to be some time when my grandkids or my grandkids, it would be cool, you know, at a time when, you know, they probably haven't picked up a magazine, and they could look at this cool old thing that grandpa or great grandpa used to do. You know, this was really cool. In fact, my kids still, you know, that was always one of their things was, you know, dad worked at Truckin magazine, worked at Mini Truckin magazine, did all these things. And, you know, hopefully I'll be able to pass them on to them
at some point, man.
You know, that they'll be able to keep that stuff, you know, cause I mean, and that's why I'm taking a trailer down because it requires a trailer to bring all this stuff back. Yeah. I mean, there's just boxes and boxes. Yeah, I've got, there's all the first issues of everything we did. I mean, in fact, I have a case or two of the first issue of Street Trucks.
Yeah, man, I tell you, that one, I think Street Trucks is going to pick up, like, I'm a collector of magazines, and I, you know, we'll talk about some of the issues here, but it was a goal of mine when we started the podcast 4 years ago. Like, we had, for the first issue, we haven't had Mike Kaufman on, but we had Rick Bentley from R Customs. He had a big portion to do with that truck. Then we've had the original three members. I call them the three main members of Cal Concepts. So to me, it's awesome that we can kind of go back and, you know, document a lot of the things that happen from an audio standpoint. But then, Brian, you wouldn't imagine, like, you know, before, I think when we first started, you mentioned, you know, a podcast, Joe Rogan, right? But like with our podcast, like, people just love these old school stories. And like, I just really enjoy what we're doing now to be able to look back, but also look towards the future, you know?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So I think that's, so let me ask you this, like, over the years, I read, like, dude, just throwing it out there, like, I always enjoyed, whether, you know, it was Truckin' and then it moved into Street Trucks, like, always enjoyed reading your editorial. And, you know, I had an opportunity to kind of understand, like, where your mindset was all those years on different rides. And I want to say during the West Coast Influence DVD, you were driving a Cadillac. Like, what other vehicles over the years outside the Blazer have you owned?
God, lots.
I thought so, yeah. Because you're kind of eclectic, right, with your mix.
Well, geez. I mean, I went from my Toyota, the S10 Blazer, to I had that K5 Blazer that ended up doing all the Pro Street, the Beastie Cruiser, which I still wouldn't mind having to this day. I sold that to Japan, and then I think it went to Australia. I've had numerous full-size Chevys, you know, 90s, I had 94, 95, 96. I had the first two-door, two-wheel drive Tahoe when they came out with that in 96, I think it was.
Nice.
Then I got more into the lifted ones. I mean, I've had the 6772s have always been my favorites, and I've had numerous Blazers and the short beds and even the two-wheel drive Suburban. God, just numerous ones. The Cadillac came lately. Like I said, since I left the publishing in 2008, I started at Ready Lift Suspension, and obviously we're a lift kit company. And so I've been more in the lifted scene, but always wanted a Cadillac, and I could never, you know, I never had the money, couldn't figure out, you know, kind of what genre, because there's different genres within the Cadillac scene, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know if it's just kind of a culture thing from when I was growing up, but I always dug the lowrider stuff. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I kind of went with the wires and kind of that kind of look. But basically, I found that one, a guy had pretty much got it sort of kind of done. So when I picked it up, I just needed to bag it and do some mechanical stuff, you know, radiator and exhaust and blah, 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 all that, you know, carburetor, so on and so forth, put a stereo in it, you know. So, but the main look was pretty much done. The chrome was all done. And the paint was all done. So I just did the finishing touches on it. And I really loved that car, but life gets in the way and... Mm-hmm. Needed to sell it.
Yep, got it. So, and
someday I'll have another one.
Yeah, and that's what I kind of had seen from your social media. And like now, you have like a wagon, right? The black wagon?
Oh, I'm a wagon freak.
Yeah, I thought so.
Yeah, today is a good day for Audi wagon freaks because Audi announced that the RS6 Avant, the most coveted wagon of all time, is coming to the USA. So, yeah, that's a... Of course, I could never afford one, but still, I mean, I'll get to see one and probably ride one and maybe drive one, but it's way outside my pay grade.
Yeah, no, I totally get it. I'm like a big Lincoln Continental fan. Like, you know, you talk about the Cadillacs, and when the new Lincoln came out, before they did the suicide door, the 80, you know, the 80 of those, I was kind of like, man, I'd love to have one. But I'm like, dude, for me, it would be like, you know, 10 years down the road when they depreciate a lot and then maybe get one like that, you know. So.
Well, it's just crazy how expensive everything's gotten. I mean, if you look back, I mean, I my Toyota truck, dude, new in 1985 cost $9,000.
Yeah, it's.
I mean, that was.
It's insane.
It's insane. I mean, we get these trucks coming through here all the time, dude. And there's not a one that's got a sticker on it that's less than $50,000.
Yeah.
And it just blows my mind how people can afford this stuff these days. But anyway, that's another story.
No, I know. It's and I remember you would write editorials. I think it was you where, you know, we were talking about back in the day when gas was going to go up. And everybody's like, well, I got to get a non-gas guzzler. And you're kind of like, well, man, if you really think about it, you're not spending, I mean, you're spending a little bit more if you got a tight budget when gas goes up, but it's not like if you go and you buy a new car, you're going to have a huge payment for like 6 or 7 or 8 years, whatever they're doing now. So I'm kind of the like mine, like I'm going to keep driving one I have. And then when something comes out that depreciates, maybe I'll get one.
I mean, I did that. I went in 2008 when the gas crunch got really bad.
Mm-hmm.
I was driving my Silverado that I still have, mm-hmm. and you know, at 44 miles one way going to work, you know, that got a little pricey.
Oh yeah.
So I went down and bought a little Chevy Cobalt. Of course, you know, can't leave nothing stock ever. And, you know, lowered it and wheels and tires. You know, I got it. I can't drive stock, and I just can't. It's just not in my DNA to drive stock. But the money I saved in fuel, because it was such a drastic difference, actually made the car payment.
Right. So, but to your point, you're smart. You kept the truck. Like some people are like, well, I'm going to trade in my vehicle. I'm like, no, keep the truck, man. If you keep the truck, you're good.
I still have it. Bought it new in 2003, and I still have that truck, and it's only got 123,000 miles on it.
Damn. Yeah, that's, yeah.
You know, it's funny. I was like, oh, man, you know, I've got my 4Runner and my lifted 4Runner I use for wheeling. And, you know, my Audi's all lowered and done up, and that's my daily. And I got my truck that's actually used more for hauling shit now than anything else. But I'll keep that thing probably forever. It's just that good of a – it's always been that good of a truck. It used to be lowered. Now it's lifted two-wheel drive. So it used to be lowered on 22s, but now it's lifted on 35s.
Got it. So when you think back, kind of talking about the magazine era, when you were at Truckin before you got the street trucks, you know, what was the vibe like back in those days? I mean, was it very similar to what street trucks was, or any kind of funny stories you can share, anything you can remember?
God, you're really testing my memory now, man. I'm 52 years old. I can't remember what the hell I had for breakfast. It's funny, as I knew this would come up and I thought about it, it's like, you know, every day there for 10 years, like I said, you know, we were trucking for 10 years, or I was anyways, mm-hmm. It, you know, every day was an adventure. I mean, there's all kinds of just goofy stuff where, like, in fact, I photographed Steve's F-100 for him for street trucks a couple of years ago, and he was over and we were having dinner, and we just got on this roll, you know. Getting us all together, all these little things started coming back of all this, the little stuff, just mm-hmm. the little things that were our day to day grinds. Like, you know, one day we're sitting there in our little cubicles writing, and the guys were doing roofing, and the guy fell through the roof and landed on, which was then, God, what was his name? Frank, I can't remember his last name, landed on his desk, boom, right in front of us, you know. Just those, just little stuff like that. It just was day to day that, you know, that I still remember, you know, we're talking about Courtney, all the, you know, Courtney was a card, so he always had stories and was loved to tell them.
Yeah, definitely.
One of them I still remember this day was getting the call, like, oh, Courtney's in jail. What's Courtney in jail for? I had to fight or something. It's okay. Well, Courtney comes in and tells us about how he ran the, you know, some guy punked one of his friends or something, I don't know, and he ended up taking this dude's head and running it down the stucco wall of a house at a party and turning it into a cheese grater. And, you know, so he ended up going to jail. And I just, just like I said, there's just so many things. It's kind of one of those bonfire deals, you know, you sit around a bonfire with a bunch of beers and you just start talking and they just start rolling out, I'm sure. And,
definitely.
I mean, we did, you know, we did a lot of hair, you know, a lot of goofy stuff back then.
Yeah, and I almost, I mean, like when I was
nine.
Yeah, exactly. And I remember when I was younger, like I didn't really like writing and stuff, but now like I've been reading, you know, a lot more books and it's like, you could almost, like, you get to a point, you retire, you know, you do whatever you're going to do. Like, you could probably almost write a book, you know. You think back to, man, just all the epic times. And to your point, maybe those magazines will kind of bring back, you know, you thumb through those one of those years, you know. But, yeah, it seems like back in those days, you guys had a lot of fun, man.
I have been extremely blessed to be able to have the career that I had then and even now. But, you know, I said, I came straight out of the military, didn't have no clue what I was going to do with my life, walking into the dream job of being able to get paid to live in the life that was a hobby for me. It was awesome. And at a time when, again, where everybody kind of looked up to everything you did, because, you know, magazines were the epitome of, I mean, if you built something, your dream was to get it in the magazine. I kind of feel sorry. I don't want to say feel sorry. It's probably not the right word, but it's kind of a bummer in a ways to me. There's so much incredible stuff built now compared to even then. I mean, the things that are built today are just light years ahead of the stuff that was built then. The mechanisms for getting the appreciation and the accolations are completely different now. Like I said, people, you know, their dream was to build something and get it on the cover of one of, you know, our magazines, Truckin, Mini Truckin, whatever it was. It could be a competitor like Sport Truck or something like that. But that was, you know, that was the dream to be fulfilled. You know, it's kind of fortunate those days are not available to people now, and maybe it's just because, you know, life and society is completely different, and the way we measure appreciation is completely different.
Yeah, and it's like we're fortunate we partnered with, I call it like a regional magazine. It's kind of homegrown and they've grown a lot. Like, it's called All Time Low Magazine, and the cool thing about it is, you know, obviously it's not in a newsstand, but for the mini truckers, they really like it. And then I certainly appreciate that Street Trucks is still around, but to me, I won't say the name of the other magazine that's out there. It's kind of like it's becoming more less and less. And I'm just like, you know, I hate to see any magazine go away. But, you know, from the heyday, like you said, to now, that other book, if you will, is definitely almost like non-existent, which is crazy. But let me ask you this. I was, you know, on this, the last few episodes, because we're, believe it or not, this is the 20th anniversary of the premiere issue of Street Trucks. It was August 99, if you can believe that. And what we did for the listeners is I kind of pulled out the first 15 issues. And, you know, I kind of been going through them, talking about, you know, the cool stuff of that era, you know, 20 years ago. And you know, we're like on issue like 6 and 7, I think, for this episode that we're kind of going through. But when I look back, like I looked at this before we started recording. Out of the first 15 issues, Brian, you shot 13 of the covers, dude. That is, to me, is awesome.
Well, and thanks. You got to remember, for us, it was a job. And we, you know, it was our job to put together. Now, I guess let me take it back. Let me flip this back a little bit.
Okay.
When we started, when we decided to do this, Courtney and Steve and I, and we brought Bob Hayes on, which I know Bob Hayes is, be our ad coordinator. I'm sorry, our ad director. And he's like, you know, here's this super nucleus of enthusiasts. And so we're like, you know, what is going to be the menu? How are we going to create this recipe? And we're like, let's make the magazine that we know we've always wanted to make with no restrictions. And it's funny, it kind of goes back to, you were talking about my column called In the Groove. And I used to get letters because, you know, people didn't email, because very few people had email then, right?
Right.
I used to get tons of letters. people are digging it, you know, because we just, you know, we came out just swinging our, just, we wanted our photos to be different, and we challenged ourselves to take better photos, to do things differently, to create, like I said, a magazine so that when people saw it for the first time, because, you know, we knew that one, people would know that it would be a good book because it was done by us, but we wanted them to really like go, bam, dude, this looks different and I really dig this. I mean, that was what we wanted. And it, to me, it's like all the part of my job as the managing editor portion was, you know, I built out what features went in the magazine, you know, which tech articles and so on and so forth, did the layout and everything else. And so I wanted the entire presentation when someone got to the back page to go, wow.
Like, I can't wait for the next one. Yeah.
Well, there was, you know, to almost have that coffee table kind of feel, you mm-hmm. know, like it belongs on the coffee table out, just, you know, to really have that look. And, you know, my deal is I don't care who shot the cover. I don't care who shot the photos, who shot what. They just got to be the best stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And this, you know, I know maybe a lot of them ended up being my photos at the time. It just kind of worked out that way, but it wasn't selected that way. Like, okay, it's your responsibility to shoot.
Right,
it was the two of us. I said it was Courtney and I, and we, you know, we were trying to create as much as we could, and it just kind of worked out that a lot of them were mine. Now, granted, too, that was a point in my career where challenging myself to take better photos, you know, that was kind of where it started to really kind of show itself.
Mm-hmm.
Still to this day, that was the issue. It was our departing issue. I think it was 2005, August, I think it was 2005, the Black Dooley, what's his name?
Yes, dude, that's my favorite. Paul Rivera. That's my favorite. Paulie,
yeah.
Yes.
It's still my favorite. It's still to this day. And, you know, but again, that was, you know, we had the flexibility to really challenge ourselves creatively to put together something based on our enthusiasm and kind of set the bar a little higher too.
Mm-hmm.
And by setting the bar a little higher, people would build things a little bit better and a little bit, you know, challenge themselves to build things a little better. You know, we like to think that we kind of help usher people to be more creative, because there's only 12 issues a year. So sure. There's only 12 covers. Yep. So there's only going to be 12 trucks out there that are going to get that glory. So, you know, it's like everybody's buying for that position, you know, and it was really, I mean, one of the great things was, you know, Courtney had so many relationships. I mean, he was just such an ambassador that, you know, we tasted success right out of the gate. So people would come or offer their vehicle to us first instead of Sport Truck or Truckin' or anybody else. You know, and that was another portion of why a lot of the magazine covers and magazines in general look so good is because we had access to some of the best builds at that time.
Yes. Well, I'm glad that you brought that up because I was going to ask you, and I was like, man, if I ask Brian this, he's going to be like, man, dude, you know how many covers I shot? But so just set the record straight. November 2005, I have the issue right here with Paulie's dually on it, okay? That is my favorite dually of all time. It's my favorite Street Trucks cover to date. That's your favorite one that you shot, right? For a
Absolutely.
Cover. Now, here's...
that. See, we had the luxury then of being able to rent Evoque, which is that water pad that you see it on.
Yeah, so that's what I was going to ask you, right? So like May of 2000, I have it here. It's the orange two-door Blazer, right? The Chicks Ride. And
yes.
Those had very similar. And then there was a crew cab dually that you shot that was in like the November 2000 issue. And then, yep, that one, that was the table of contents, right? Were all of those shot like in that same particular spot, you think?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. That was this place called Evoque. It's Emergency Vehicle Operations Center out in San Bernardino.
Okay.
At that time, it's out by Glen Helen. At that time, we could rent that facility. Mm-hmm. That was a giant skid pad. It was kind of like a football field long and probably two football fields wide. And it was like perfectly flat. And they would flood it. And then the emergency vehicles would go driving across it and slide all over the place.
Yes.
And that's how they train them to drive. But like I said, they don't. do that at certain times so we could rent it. And I mean, it wasn't cheap. That's why you didn't see a lot of stuff done there. But in some ways, it's good that it wasn't, because it's so it's such an iconic place. You don't want to overuse it.
Right, right.
So we would reserve it for, you know, the really elite looking kind of vehicles. And also, based on its location in these hills, it only worked well in the fall into the winter. That's the only time it really worked well with the light.
Got it.
If you tried to use it in the spring or summer, the light was completely different and it would look completely different. But yeah, I love shooting at that place. Right when the sun would set, the wind would calm down, the water would go like glass, and it was just point the camera and shoot, and it would come out awesome.
Yeah, I was going to ask, like, hey, did you guys have to rent a water truck? Like, what was involved? But yeah, it makes total sense now. And for some reason, I maybe you wrote about that at one point, but I do think, like, these three, like, literally I have them in front of me, and obviously the table of contents with the dually, man, that thing came out great. I mean, and that red interior on Paulie's dually, like, dude, to this day, I mean, the listeners know, I'm like, that truck had so much style with the Impala dash, the roll down back window, which is super rare. I mean, that thing is just, I really think that if you brought it out today, he's still killing the scene, man. I mean, it's that nice.
Last time I asked somebody about that a year or two ago, I think he or somebody close to him still has that.
That's what I heard.
It's just kind of sitting and just kind of, I don't want to say rotting, but it's just.
Yeah, it's like aging like wine or something. I don't know. So let me ask you this. Exactly. When you talk about, you mentioned film earlier, and when I started going to shows about 23 years ago in 96, I would take literally film. My friends and I, we would take film, and we would shoot like show coverage like we were shooting for a magazine, but we did it for ourselves, and I'm glad that we did. But do you kind of remember around the time that you guys transitioned from film to digital, and did you personally, because I want to say you may have even wrote about this, where you kind of mentioned like you were so old school, like you didn't want to switch?
Well, that was a reason. There's a couple of reasons why. But first, yeah, we it was always transparency. We shot with medium format cameras, all of us. And, it, you know, because the stuff had to get drum scanned and these big files so they could go in and be printed and so on and so forth. It's completely different. Mm-hmm. I still have my first digital camera, which I was opposed to it. Paul Morton, who did, who worked on the Auto Sound and Security magazine.
Yep.
He was the first to kind of embrace that. And, you know, I still have my first, a Nikon. It's like 3.4 megapixel camera thing. I still have it in a box somewhere. Digital wasn't suited for feature type photography. Mm-hmm. It started to work well for doing tech stories and event coverage and things like that, where the images that we would print would be pretty small.
Mm-hmm.
So there was more flexibility there. I resisted the digital change until probably, it was probably 2002, 2003, somewhere in there, when the cameras started to get to where the size of the sensor started to get to a point where you could end up with files that could be blown up to spreads. Mm-hmm. It took a while for it to transition, but it was also ushered in at the time because we shot, like I said, medium format film. You know, shit was expensive.
Mm-hmm.
and the processing gets expensive. And mm-hmm. So when you switch into digital, it would save the company just tons of money. So they kind of urged us to go that direction. And that's unfortunately about that time, you know, the cameras were starting to get better, and the quality of the images get better. And of course, you know, once you go digital, and you really, you know, for me as a photographer, uh-huh. a creative type person, to be able to bring my own images in now and then, you know, develop and work my own Photoshop magic, that was just that I just loved it.
Mind-blowing. People forget that, like, cameras were like 1 megapixel, you know, that type of deal. And then, you know, like, cell phone cameras were like 0.3 megapixels. It's beyond what I would have ever thought back in the day, that like I could take a phone. Now granted, we know that it's not like, you know, magazine quality, but you know, you could take a phone and capture some of the images that you can. I mean, who would have ever thought? I mean, it's just insane to me.
So I'm an image nut. Mm-hmm. I'm a photo freak, and you know, my iPhone 10, whatever alphabet number it's got, I don't remember anymore. I mean, you know, it takes such incredible photos, and I'll even export them and bring them into my computer. It's like, damn. In fact, you know, for my work now, I do, you know, all the photography and all the videography and everything else. And for a lot of stuff where it's not, it doesn't have to be a high production value, I just use my phone for video.
Yeah, it is internal crazy.
Stabilization. It's, I mean, it shoots in 4K. I mean, dude, but yeah, if you were to take this phone back 10 years ago,
yeah,
people think you were a freaking alien or something.
Right,
I mean,
exactly. Like you're driving a DeLorean. Yeah.
I guess 10 years ago, probably pre-smartphone altogether, probably. But yeah, it's completely different. You know, that's the difference between, and to me, the biggest thing that has actually been to the magazine, to magazines as a whole's detriment is, you know, whenever there's events and things like that, yeah, it's like yourself. You could go around and take your own photos and stuff, but you had no ability to share those.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the magazines came in, is, you know, we were, you know, we had the flexibility to be able to share the captures of those events with others.
Globally, basically. Yep.
You know, social media is, I mean, heck, I mean, it's just like what you do. I mean, live, your events live.
Yeah.
It's like, why do I go buy a magazine now when I'm seeing it all live right here in person? You know, society just changed that much. And unfortunately, magazine not made the cut.
Yeah. Well, thinking back, when I was looking through the first issue recently and I covered it, I looked, you know, Steve Stillwell in his column, he kind of has the trench coat thing on, and he, in there, you see like different potential, what could have been the first covers. And do you recall, like in the beginning, was there like, did you guys do, like, I remember when ESPN, the magazine came out, they had like test runs that they gave the editors and stuff. And they were trying to figure out like, okay, well, what's going to be the first issue? Was there a debate ever about Mike Kaufman's truck being on the first issue? Do you recall with Street Trucks?
No, we wanted to, I mean, I'm 100% certain of this, or almost 100% certain of this, but I mean, we knew we wanted the baddest of the bad, and the mm-hmm. timing was just perfect, because Mike was just finishing that up.
Yes.
And I we were all pretty much in agreement that if we could get Mike to let us shoot that truck, would be, just incredibly iconic. Yeah, for us. And of course, Mike was, yeah, let's do it. In fact, I remember when I was going up there to photograph it, it was, man, we looked all over for a damn place to photograph that truck. And we ended up photographing that thing in his driveway.
That's what I thought. Yeah. And to me, the Paradox Colorado Custom Wheels were big, good friends with the owners now. You know, Mike, he's a great guy over there. But to have, like, I think Stillwell wrote about it one time, an X Marks the Spot type cover where you have the hood off, super detailed. I mean, the Cal Concepts paint, like that cover, like literally, I remember hearing in Florida when that magazine came out, everybody's like, dude, there's a new magazine out. We drove around looking. And as soon as we found it, we're like, subscribe. And I was telling the listeners recently that the first year, technically in 99, it was bi-monthly, because you guys were kind of ramping up into the 2000 where it became monthly, of course. But to me, when you guys put that one out, you said it earlier, dude, you came out swinging, man.
Well, that was, and part of the reason it's bi-monthly is whenever you start a magazine like that, I mean, yeah, back then you had to set up contracts with the printing houses,
okay,
and distribution, and you know, it's a financial gamble for them for every magazine that they bring on board. So mm-hmm. that's why they're bi-monthly to begin with, to begin ramping up distribution. That's part of the reason why it's bi, and that, and two, we didn't want to burden ourselves with the payload of trying to produce a monthly magazine with a relatively small staff.
Sure.
I mean, we leaned, you know, we started to lean heavily on our freelancers that started to, you know, which a lot of more relationships we had from the trucking days. But, you know, it took time to build up the feature file. In fact, I remember, I think it may have been, it was around that time I went to the F-100 Super Nationals, which I used to love to go to. I shot 22 features there.
Damn, that weekend?
Well, because we had nothing.
Yeah.
I had nothing in the art. I mean, my file drawer had nothing in it. So, yeah, I mean, we needed a good solid year of hustling just to try to build the content file up so that we could be selective about the content that we put in the magazine so that it was really good. We didn't want to be in a position where we were scrambling for anything we could get, because ultimately it ends up looking that way.
Correct. I mean,
you'll see something cool, and then it's like, what's this in there for? It's kind of whatever. Right. Well, we wanted the whole thing from page one to page 96 or whatever it was to be good all the way through. So, you know, it'd take a little time to build up that portfolio to be able to give the readers the best content that we felt that we could deliver to them.
Yep, got it. And I think the last question I have about street trucks is, like, is there any, like, maybe a fact or anything else that you could think of about the magazine that maybe the listeners don't know? Maybe something early on that you can think of that maybe stuck in your mind? I always try to, like, share different, like, little angles with the listeners, you know, about different things.
Street trucks was the birth of anger.
The birth of anger?
Yep. See, you're already like, whoa, what's this? Yeah, at the time, I probably already talked about it, but, you know, we all were trucking, and it was becoming very corporate and very, you know, ad-driven, to where our enthusiasm was really starting to wane. Mm-hmm. And when they let Steve go, that really pissed us off, because, you know, Steve's like dad.
Yep.
And we were really bitter about that. And so when we got over there to start, you know, street trucks, it was this vindication, you know. It's like, in fact, you mentioned my column. Like, I still remember the time Steve came in and finally says, all right, guy, man, you got to tone it down. You know, because looking back, you know, I was pretty ruthless. I mean, I bash those guys pretty hard, because, you know, they just, you know, I didn't like what they were doing to publishing and doing the Truckin' magazine, you know, at that time. And that was one of the things that most people don't know. It wasn't one of those things where we just like, hey, let's start a new magazine, this would be great.
Yeah, that'll be easy.
There's more to it. It was a set of circumstances that ended up being extremely fortunate and created a environment where we got, I guess you could say, like a second lease on life to be mm-hmm. able to really do what we used to do, you know, 10 years prior, but in a more modern way and with incredible flexibility and no corporate people, you know, saying you can and can't do this. I mean, you know, we used our own best judgment on everything that was produced. And so it was literally a creation from the core of enthusiasm at that time.
Well, and you may, so I appreciate you sharing that, and you may not want to, I don't know how far we want to go down the bunny trail. I mean, I only got a few more questions after this, but like when I heard something recently, like, so you think about, you guys hit the floor running and we all love this magazine, and I could go through, you know, however many issues that you guys were all there as a team, and then something kind of happened. Was that some corporate takeover stuff? And then they go, well, now we got you, Steve, and now you're gone again. You guys lasted for years, but was there a story behind that on why you guys ultimately left?
Yes, there was. The guy that ran, and I said, I don't need to mention
sure,
any names,
sure.
But the guy that was the corporate guy that was in charge of the publishing company that owned Truckin' and at the time, none of us got along with him. And he's the one that had a conflict of personalities, and that's basically what it was with Steve, again, our father. Mm-hmm. And after whatever it was, 5-6 years, Y Visionary had sold and been bought by a company that, lo and behold, that same guy was put in charge of.
Yeah.
We were like, nah, we're not having any part of this. We've already been down this road. We know exactly what's going to happen. And thankfully at that time, Todd Horn, who was previously in the Truckin' days, was one of our ad salesmen. He had started a group of magazines called 10 Magazines. And it was basically,
yes.
You know, it was 10 Truck World, and had all these online magazines, you know, Tacoma World and so on and so forth, and was looking to grow his content and his readers. And he thought, hey, man, here's the quote unquote A team. I have the opportunity to bring them on board. And they said, it just kind of worked out so perfect for us because we were like, you know, we didn't want any part of the old regime that was now in the place where we had built. And, you know, so we had a great opportunity to go work at 10. So we, Courtney, Steve and I, we all gave our notice the same day. So we're out, and went over there. But I will say it was not hard. I'm sorry. It was not easy. It was very hard to do that, to leave Street Drugs.
Yeah, because you guys had created, really, for lack of better terms, like magic, dude. I mean, it was that good.
Well, it's just we knew the outcome. We knew that the clash of personalities between them and us wasn't going to work. It already had not worked in the past and was not going to work again. Mm-hmm. So we knew that, you know, and so even if we tried to hang on, we weren't going to hang on, and things would go sideways. So, but I can tell you from myself and Courtney and Steve, all of us, it was not an easy decision to make because none of us are quitters.
Yeah, sure. But to your point, you saw you had the foresight to go, you know, we know we're going to get potentially railroaded here. So it's like, you know what? We're going to control our own destiny.
Exactly. Exactly.
Got it.
And that's how that came about. And we were at 10 for, I guess, what, 3 years, I think, something like that.
Yep.
And it was kind of a challenging time because it was that time of trying to bridge that gap between print and digital.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed, not just for us, but for any publishing company trying to do the same thing. It was really hard to do. We didn't, you know, nobody fully understood how people consumed content. We knew that it was changing. So here we were doing a print magazine, but then we were immediately putting it online in a PDF kind of format and then putting on the content into the forums. And we're like, wait a minute, you know, how does this work? This is, you know, to us, we're like, how's a magazine supposed to survive?
Right. It'd be like, you know, releasing a movie. A couple of people have, over the years, they've released a movie in the theater at the same time you can rent it at home. And you kind of go, well, if I don't have to go pay, you know, $20 for popcorn, I'll just stay home, you know, that type of thing.
So. Yeah, that was a real challenge mentally. I mean, for all of us, it was just trying to interpret that. It was just very, very bizarre. And, you know, and unfortunately, you know, 10 didn't last very long. And thankfully, you know, I ended up in a great place and Steve ended up in a great place. And of course, Courtney didn't, but it was the end of all of our careers.
The run,
Steve had been doing this since the 70s.
Yeah, I know, man. He's because, like, and he had the foresight. I think, you know, those guys back then when they were, we've talked to some guys before, and, you know, they say, well, man, this mini truck stuff's really taken off. And it's like, well, we're doing trucking. Well, man, we'll do mini trucking. And it was like, they were just always like kind of thinking ahead, and they're like, boom, okay, let's do this. And then mini trucking had a damn good run, you know, from 88, that one issue there, and then all the way to 2014, I think it was. So, yeah, it's mind-boggling.
But yeah, there's probably a whole lot of your listeners who don't know that Mini Trucking Magazine was the creation of Steve Stillwell and Alan Paradise.
100%. 100%. And if they didn't have that foresight to see in SoCal and just in general that whole thing taken off, it may have just never been created. It just would have been trucking, and they would have ran a couple minis like you guys did here and there, you know?
Well, yeah, I mean, right, and in the 80s, that's when, particularly late 80s, you know, they started to realize, Steve and Alan and Larry, and they started to realize that a whole lot of the trucks and the majority of the shows that they go to are mini truck dominated now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that kind of warrants having their own magazine. And Kenny Paul was doing some writing too, and he kind of contributed to that as well. And so they put that first magazine out as a test, a feeler to see how it would sell and see how it would do, and did real well. And I said, that's when I came on for issue number two.
Yeah, in issue one, just a couple weeks ago, like a lot of us follow, and one of our buddies even sells, like as a hobby, he buys and sells Mini Trucking Magazine. And what was crazy is the first issue, that was a mint copy. Like literally, I don't know if this person got it from an estate sale or they just had them, but all of their copies were mint in the that premiere issue went for seemingly perfect number, $420 plus I think it was free shipping. But I was like, damn, that issue is becoming more and more iconic, you know, even though it wasn't the best issue because it was kind of like you said, like it was like a test issue, but it's because it's number one, you know, the mini truckers, we all want it. But
$400, huh?
Yeah, I know, right? So I was gonna say, you know,
I'm pretty sure mine's mint. It's in a sleeve.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you know, hit me up first, give me first dibs at it, and then you know, go. Nah. But
I'll let you know after I go through my collection. I know there's, like I said, there's my first issue of Truckin. It's not mint, but it's pretty nice because it's in a plastic sleeve. All that stuff's
stored
away.
That's cool. Well, the few more questions I have is like, you know, and we kind of established, we do know that some of the magazines have went away, especially like with Sport Truck. Tailgate was kind of that iconic, you know, for a while. And then, of course, Mini Truckin'. But if you would have thought back to like the 80s, you know, now with Engage, you know, they have Street Trucks still going, moving on to the 21st year now. You got the C10 Builder's Guide, and then they even rolled out the F100 Builder's Guide. Like, would you ever thought that the truck stuff would have evolved this much into what it is now?
Oh, for sure. I mean, we were doing that back in the 90s. I, besides doing Truckin', I did a magazine called Chevy Truckin'. I did a Ford Truckin'. I started Classic Trucks magazine.
Oh, that's a good point. We were doing, I forgot about Classic Trucks.
We were doing niche publications back then. I mean, we started Sport Compact Car. It was a offshoot because of the mascots that were part of the Mini Truck Club, because back in the day, Mini Truck Clubs could have one mascot, and that mascot was usually a compact car of some sort. And you know, it was a little Honda, something like that. Well, that kind of started to take off, and basically they were car versions of Mini Trucks that were being shown. So we started Sport Compact Car magazine. So we had numerous offshoot magazines back then.
Yeah, and like the Chevy Truckin' and those types, like I have a few of those here and there, but I almost wish that I would have had more of those because, you know, to your point, there you go. What was cool is like it would sometimes be a mix of like features you guys already shot or things like that, but it was like there were really good issues, you know? Like Crew Cut, I think I have one of it had Crew Cut in it. It was like, oh, that's cool. There's another magazine with Crew Cut, you know? So.
Yeah, I mean, and largely, in fact, they ended up killing Chevy Truckin' because I was putting too much effort into it.
Wow, they're just going, hey, it's too big of a budget, or it's costing.
Because a lot of people don't know, but especially in the 90s up through Street Trucks, all of the images that you saw in print and the way the magazine was put together and everything else, I created. It was my responsibility to do that.
Got it.
And so I would pick all the features and I would pick everything that would go in those books. So when I had like Chevy Truckin', which being a Chevy fan, I would kind of keep some stuff aside and try to put it in there to give Chevy Truckin' its own identity, as opposed to being a catch-all of things that we've already ran in Truckin'. And after a while, they kind of got wind of that and didn't dig it. So.
I see. Yeah, they're going, man, we could pump more into this, get our subs up even more, whatever.
They're like, you need to be doing that on Truckin', the big moneymakers, so... I'm like, all right, I get it, but that sucked because I really enjoyed doing that book. It was a lot of fun doing that book.
Here's something that just came to mind, like talking about the industry. Do you like from a normal listener, right? Is it from a magazine being ran standpoint, even back then, we'll say not even today, is it the subscribers or is it their advertisers or is it the newsstand sales or is it just a mix of everything that really keeps it going?
Depends. If you go back into the 70s and the 80s, it was about the subscribers. I mean, the advertisers subsidize costs, but it was about the subscribers all the way through the 90s. I mean, you know, we were selling 200,000 plus copies a month of Truckin', and they made money.
Got it.
It was about, I would say, the mid-90s, if my memory serves me correctly. When things kind of started to change, a lot of it had to do with actually the the print houses started consolidating and distribution started consolidating. So us as publishers, started making less money per issue that we sold. And that's where they started to transfer over to focusing on the advertising portion of it to try to, you know, keep the publishing industry afloat, mm-hmm. because they weren't making the money off of the subscriber anymore. Whereas, like I said, you know, prior to that, you know, particularly in the '80s and stuff, the subscriptions is what kept the doors open and kept people employed producing the magazines.
Understood. Well, before I kind of wrap it up, I do have just a couple other just general questions for you that will be quicker, but did you have anything else you wanted to share in terms of any of the stuff you've done over the truck years, you know, from Truckin' to Mini Truckin' to Street Trucks and then even to 10? Was there anything else you wanted to share on those topics, Brian?
No, just that I've been extremely blessed to be able to be that guy that was lucky to be in the right place at the right time. You know, it could have been anybody else, mm-hmm. and it just worked out that it was me, and I was a fit for Steve's team that he was building. And, you know, I've always said it to anybody who's asked, because I felt very blessed to have that opportunity that ended up being, you know, an 18-year career in mm-hmm. that segment. It sucks that print magazines have basically went the way of the dodo bird, per se. I mean, mm-hmm. compared to in the past. And, you know, some listeners may think, well, wait a minute, you know, I still get it and everything. If you were a part of magazine history back then and compare it to now, it's dynamically different. Mm-hmm. And that's where, you know, my feelings come from, because I got to experience it in its heyday, when it was the end all be all. I mean, that was, I mean, you know, there was nothing better than being in a magazine. It is as much like I sit around here and say, yeah, you know, hopefully someday it would be like that again. Well, you know, reality sucks. It's not going to be like that again, you know? So
yeah.
I have the fortunate opportunity to be able to appreciate what was, and hopefully there's a lot of people listening who were around that time who can appreciate that as well. You know, it's funny, you go into people's shops and they still have those same boards hanging on the wall from the 90s.
Yes.
You know, the feature truck and the different things like that. You know, if you guys ever get a chance, you should go to Doug Starbucks shop in Riverside.
Yes, I know. You know, a few Doug? People have told us we need to have him on, but we need to stop by there.
Yeah, I mean, it's like a museum. You know, because Doug's been around so long, pretty much as long as I have. In fact, I remember he was at Color Concepts. I think it was Color Concepts he was at, and we had met. And so we kind of ran parallel through our careers. But yeah, if you go to his shop, I mean, it is, you'd be blown away by all the stuff on the wall. You know, and to me, that's special. That's extremely special, because that doesn't exist anymore. I mean, everything we consume is in a digital format. It's not hanging on the wall like that anymore. So it's like, so you go to a place like Doug's, and I said, you go in there, and it's just, it's like a museum of the past. It's just incredible. And I'm sure there's a lot of other shops like that around, you know, that have that similar decoration where everything's hanging on the walls that. I mean, that's, to me, that's just.
Well, what's funny is the main plaque place, I don't know what year they went into business, but, you know, we kind of had a deal with them early on with the podcast, because they're right here in the Tampa Bay area. And I would imagine in the news, exactly. And, you know, I've been to the facility, I picked up a couple plaques there. And what is amazing is, to your point, like, you know, the listeners are going, well, we do still have Street Trucks, we have the Builder's Guides, you know, we've got All Time Low, like, definitely we do. But I would venture to say, like, if you went to the bookstore and you look, you know, you go to the big bookstores by me, there are still a lot of magazines, but I really truly think, and I found the Wikipedia page the other day that had all of the, I was trying to find the word to use, and it's defunct, right? All the defunct magazines, and there are a lot of them. So to your point, you know, I know listeners are going, man, I still get my magazine, but it has changed over time. And I'm thankful that, like, Chris and Nicole with Street Trucks, like, dude, I would have never thought this, Brian. Like, they're in Florida, dude, and they're the edit. You know, Chris is the editor, So I am thankful that they're carrying it on and they're doing a good job.
Absolutely.
But to your point, the dynamic has definitely changed in the magazine world.
So. And we always have, and I can remember in 1995, 6, whatever it was, we're sitting and this is at Truckin, and we're having our weekly
staff
meeting with casual staff meeting in the magazine and everything else. And I remember something about the internet came up, and I remember saying this. I can visualize it right now. You guys got to be careful because the internet is going to kill us. And they're like, you're crazy. There's no way, no way. And a lot of that was spawn. You know, I thought about, why did I make that response? And a lot of that was spawn was, I got internet connection at my house. Ooh, you know, I had my AOL dial-up.
Right?
And I found myself, instead of sitting on the couch reading magazines, I soon found myself sitting at my computer, hanging out on all these forums and stuff, right?
Yep.
But, you know, the AOL chats and all the different crap they had.
Well,
and I was using that as like, look, I have a select amount of time in a day to consume things that I'm interested in.
Sure.
And that was always, you know, to that point, it had always been print. Well, now all of a sudden there's this box that's got my attention, and it's got my attention all the way into the time I go to bed. And I started, as I was telling them, I was like, look, this is going to happen and it's going to suck. Thankfully, it took longer than I thought it would. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally, I'm very thankful that it did. But I also believe that at some point there's going to be a revolution. I know it's probably not the right word to use, but a revolution that is to where print is going to be more important than it is now. And it's kind of like classic cars, you know. Mm-hmm. They were cool and they were new, and then they went through that 20-year cycle where like, oh, that hunk of junk, whatever, mm-hmm. you know, sitting in the back of whatever, collecting dust, whatever, and all of a sudden now they're the hot new thing again.
Mm-hmm.
I think that magazines, as long as there's people who are willing to assemble a magazine, put one together, and a publishing house or a printer that's willing to print it and a means to distribute it, as long as that exists, excuse me, there's a potential to be that kind of revolution to where people will want that again. I just believe that magazines are just far too iconic to just go away.
Yeah, I agree, because so many people say, I just
people
like...
people still want to keep them together.
Yeah,
you know?
And so many people say, I just like to, you know, it's just like a lot of older folks, like they when they read books, they don't like to read them digitally. They say, I just like the book in my hand, you know, that type of thing. So, and we're starting to see that.
I can't get the digital book.
Yeah.
I can't.
Yeah.
This is too weird.
It is weird, and you know, we're starting to see it with All Time Low magazine, because with the mini truck, there's like this resurgence that you're talking about, almost like with the print. We saw that a few years ago. Like, I'm a big music guy, right? And unfortunately, with these, you know, with streaming, I love streaming, but it's becoming harder and harder to find. Like, if you want to buy a CD from your favorite artist, right? Okay, so you can go out, you can go to their website, and you can buy it. It's like $16, shipping, that's $20, right? But for a while there, and it was a few years back, like, vinyl had made such a resurgence that it was outpacing like CD sales. Right. And I thought that was awesome, because who would have ever thought, you're like, vinyl, you know, but vinyl sounds really good. And as you know, like how trends come back, that's what was happening with the younger crowd. They're going, oh, this is wow, this big record. Oh, look at the artwork. So to me, I kind of equate it to the same thing.
Oh, absolutely. I said, and maybe I'm just being optimistic, but I like to think that, you know, it's that, you know, roughly a 20-year cycle that magazines will have to survive through to get to that point where it just, you know, as long as there are me, you, and your listeners and people who experience magazines as a part of their life, you know, that will be a cool thing to continue to have in our life. You know, the rough part is getting through our kids and grandkids and so on and so forth who have absolutely no clue. But on the flip side, there's going to be a segment of them who are going to think it's really cool. And again, hopefully there are still people putting them, you know, taking the time to put them together and assemble the content in a magazine way that will just continue to be novel for a generation that up to a point probably never picked up a magazine. I mean, all they do is stare at the phone.
Yeah, definitely. Exactly. It's crazy. But I would highly encourage, you know, we partnered up with Radar over at the West Coast Influence. So I'd encourage everyone to go out to minitruckfilm.com and order the Blu-ray or DVD. You will see Brian on there talk about various things. Brian, what are some of the hobbies that you're into these days? You know, you kind of mentioned photography and some videography for your work. Is there any other stuff that you're really into outside of the trucks and cars?
I do. I have too many freaking hobbies.
I thought I was the only one.
That's part of my problem. I'm one of those guys that my ADD doesn't allow me to sit still. So I've got a lot of, I'm a competitive shooter. So I'm a competitive trap shooter. And that takes a lot of my time, a lot of my weekends. I enjoy it immensely. You know, since I moved up here to NorCal, wheeling has become one of my fun things to do. We got, you know, the Rubicons right here and the trails are everywhere. And so I've been finding myself there a lot. And of course, spending stupid money on my Forerunner. But those are probably the main ones that consume the majority of my time. Besides work, I'm still sitting here at work as I'm talking to you. So,
yeah, I know you were saying that earlier and I was like, dang, man. I mean, West Coast time, you're putting in the hours. What city do you live in up there?
A city called Placerville. It's actually old. There's some people. It's funny, and this annoys me. I took my kids, which you probably were taught about the California Gold Rush, right? I'm sure there's probably a lot of people listening that were. It was part of what we were taught in school, about the California Gold Rush, how California was founded, so on and so forth. You know, I take my kids, because Coloma was where the first gold was found. It was right, you know, just half an hour from here. Take my kids and they're in town, take them over there, and I'm explaining this to them and they're just like, what? And I'm like, you got to be kidding me. I mean, it's like when I was in school, I mean, that was just a huge significant part of California history and U.S. history. I mean, it was huge. Mm-hmm. But anyways, that's, you know, that's the kind of community I'm in. It's awesome. And it's between Sacramento and Lake Tahoe. It's, you know, right here close by. So of course I've been here about 3 years, and after 30 years of living in Southern California, I don't miss Southern California at all.
Nice. You have less traffic up there, I would think.
Oh, dude.
Traffic's not even a word.
Yeah. Traffic. What's that?
That's a good thing.
Traffic, traffic is the stoplight's red.
Right. Oh man, dude, it's been a pleasure, man. Like This was way more than I expected. I mean, dude, at one point, man, you'll have to nudge Steve. I know we've got some contacts, you know, with Ruben and things like that. But, man, if Steve would ever want to come on in the future and just chop it up like we did, man, that would be cool. But, man, this has been really an honor, and you've been on my list a while. So it's awesome to sit down with you, Brian.
I really appreciate it. It's not often I get to talk about the past. You know, most people, stuff that I work with, you know, they have no clue about it or don't really care. And so it's nice when you get to dig into the memory bank that, you know, like I said, when you get older, you tend to forget shit. And it's nice to sit here and start thinking about it to where I'm like, shit, I want to keep talking, man. There's a lot of memories here that's coming out.
Yeah, and that's why we do the podcast. And it's awesome because even me kind of getting in around, I mean, I was reading mini trucking in middle school. And I was into mini trucks, but really being able to get into it and meet so many people over these last 23 years and do these interviews is really a joy, man, and I love doing it. So why don't you give out, if you don't mind, your Instagram in case anybody wants to follow you, Brian?
Yeah, sure. It's BMC2U on IG, or you could just look up Brian McCormick. Either way, you'll be able to find it.
Awesome.
So you'll know you'll land there when you see a bunch of pictures of a black Audi and a red 4Runner.
Boom.
That's my cars.
Exactly. And obviously BM is Brian McCormick, but was there a tie-in to the BMC?
Yes.
Is that a... okay, so...
Yeah, there was... It's people every now and then ask me that. It goes with... Because it's capital B for Brian, M for McCormick, and there's the capital C in McCormick. So it makes
Got
sense,
it.
Right?
Yep,
well,
yep.
Paul Morton, who I mentioned before, he walked into the office one day and he's like, run BMC. And that was it, from then on, that became my nickname, so to speak.
Yeah. Very cool.
Still have it to this day. Even have the tattoo.
Man, that's badass. We recently had Cope Kessler on, who built that famous blue Astro van back in the day. It was on the cover of Auto Sound and, Mini Truckin'. And we were looking at, I know you mentioned Mike a few times for listeners. You're talking about Mike Schartzis, right? And Paul Morton and Schartzis shot that in Daytona over here in Florida in 97. And that's where I always remember Paul's name, to your point earlier, Auto Sound and Security.
Yeah, in fact, you should bring him on. He was kind of a mini truck guy as well. Mm-hmm. He was more into the sound, but he was kind of a mini truck guy as well. And he had his probably one of his most iconic. He had a 91. It was white. In fact, he's wanting to get another one to build the same one again.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you should hit him up and get him on. He'll have some great stories to tell. He was always a good talker. He was just one of those guys with just an incredible positive attitude pretty much all the time. And he was one of those guys that actually helped foster that competitiveness that we had to become better photographers. Mm-hmm. Again, I mean, you guys remember, I said this, back early 90s, and we were all, in our 20s. We were all young guys.
Mm-hmm.
And so we all had this competitive fire, and we all pushed each other competitively to take better photos and do better things. And Paul was definitely one of the guys who was right there at the forefront.
Yeah. Amazing. I added him to our list, man. That's all it took, Brian. So, man, we appreciate it, dude. Like I said, it's been a lot of fun.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah. And not first and foremost, but lastly, I just want to say, dude, we always say salute the OGs, but I mean, for someone like yourself, you got in at the right time, but man, you had a lot of passion and you put out a lot of work and you took pride in it. And I, from our lifestyle, the podcast, to you, man, I just want to say thank you, bro. Cause you gave me a lot of, good reading and, visual trucks back in the day, man. I appreciate it.
I'm glad that people still appreciate it. I mean, it's nice to know that people can look back that far and still appreciate some of the stuff that we did. I mean, it wasn't a job. It was a life. It was a life. I mean, if we didn't come to work at 8 to 5, it was a life.
And it's funny you say that, because that's why we named this. Like we went through like 20 or 30 names 4 years ago on what we're going to name the podcast. And we said, what captures, we don't want to pigeonhole ourselves into one thing. Mini trucks in 5 years might not be, as cool as they are right now. Right. We've seen that up and down, but we know our lifestyle could be a full size truck. It could be a Cadillac, like what you had. It's really what represents the low, the airbags, all that awesome stuff, truck runs, and you just nailed it. You know what I mean?
Well, that was it. And not to keep blabbering on, but going with what you said, I mean, there's nobody that owns mini trucks for their whole life,
mm-hmm.
but there is a massive amount of people who began their custom building, life that they've led to this point began with mini trucks, because mm-hmm. that was the easiest one. It was the most affordable vehicle for most of us. And two, it was the most affordable to be able to personalize. And, we've all migrated through different vehicles, different things over time. But I can tell you right now, if I had my way and had the money, I would love to have me an 84 S10 King Cab. Mm-mm. I would love to have laid out that square body. Just to me is, I love that square body.
Yeah, it's
love that.
It's so
someday
iconic, and we're starting to see more of them come back. And I think what you just said a moment ago, like when I think of a recent guest we had, John Tondro, he started as a mini trucker out of high school, started Stage One Customs. And then now he's building those like $1 million off-road trucks, working a little bit time with Robbie Gordon and things like that. So to your point, a lot of guys started, and it's just awesome to see where so many guys have ended up in terms of their careers and things like that. And many of them haven't ever forgotten where they started, and we love it.
Yeah, it's when it's in your blood, it's in your blood, and it never goes away.
And that's our lifestyle. You know it, man. Dude, man, we appreciate your candor. And, dude, if you find any extra issue number ones or number twos, those are two that I need, so I'll buy them. For mini trucking.
Of mini trucking? Yeah, I'm pretty sure I have them. Like I said, when I go down and go through the archives there, I mean, it's vast.
Yeah, man. Well, we wish you luck with the whole move and all that stuff. And, dude, just keep doing what you do, and we wish you all the success, Brian. And again, thanks for all that you've done for the truck world, brother.
All right, thanks, man. Appreciate it. Thanks for having me on.
All right, listeners, we at you. So there you have it, man. What a fun interview. Dude, we love the candor of Brian McCormick. Man, he shot us straight. He gave us all kinds of gems. And thanks, Brian, for sitting down. We certainly appreciate it. Go out there and follow him on social media via Instagram. He has a lot of cool photos. If you scroll back pretty far, you'll see a lot of the different photography stuff he's done. And, man, we really enjoyed it. So thank you guys very much for listening. Here's our rundown of our sponsors. This is brought to you by Feltham Fab and SSBB Media. Go out there and follow SSBB Media on Instagram. So All Time Low Magazine, hit up atlmagazine.com and order a subscription. Hammered Weekend Wear, that's HAMMERD, weekendwear.com. Order some real builds on your threads. Custom Car Show Productions, including Sicknick, which I'm driving to. If you're listening early on Friday, I'm driving to the show now. Lone Star Throwdown, 2020, cannot wait. Looking forward to slapping hands with Radar and Lonnie. The West Coast Influence, visit minitruckfilm.com. Order the Blu-ray or DVD. Garage Gear Clothing, same thing. Really good people behind this brand. Get out there and order some gear. Sparkles Detail is the clean team that supports the scene. Get out there and have them clean your ride at one of these shows that they're at nationwide. And then Feltham Fabrications, you heard at the top. Check him out for all your custom painted needs. He even paints custom cups, or those, I call them Yetis. He will paint those to match your graphics on your vehicle. Hit him up, Feltham Fab on Instagram. All right, you guys have a great weekend, and we'll hit you next Friday with a new episode. Our Lifestyle, the podcast. We out ya. Peace.
Way you do it, you play the guitar on the MTV. That ain't working, that's the way you do it. Money for nothing and your chicks for free. Now that ain't working, that's the way you do it. Let me tell you, damn guys ain't dumb. Maybe get a blister on your little finger, maybe get a blister on your thumb. We got to install microwave ovens, custom kitchen deliveries. We got to move these refrigerators, we got to move these color TVs. Ooh, I move on. What's that? Hawaiian noises? He's banging on the bongos like a chimpanzee. Oh, that ain't working. That's the way you do it. Get your money for nothing, get your chicks for free. We got to install microwave oven, custom kitchen deliveries. We got to move these refrigerators, we got to move these cars. American. That's the way you do it. You play the guitar on the MTV. That ain't working. That's the way you do it. Money for nothing and your chicks for free. Money for nothing.